Hello, I'm Bill Powers. I'm a neurologist and I'm the chair of the writing group for the American Heart Association focused update on the use of endovascular treatment for acute ischemic stroke. Since the publication of the last guidelines for acute ischemic stroke, there have been 8 new randomized controlled trials that have been published on the use of endovascular therapy. Therefore, the American Heart Association thought it was time to update the guidelines to take into account this new information because it will change the old guidelines and leads to a great advancement in the care of people with acute ischemic stroke. The writing group got together earlier this year to review these studies and to come up with evidence-based recommendations based on the American Heart Association guidelines for evidence-based medicine. The two primary recommendations that came out of this update of the guidelines are, one, that treatment with intravenous RTPA still remains the gold standard for treatment of acute ischemic stroke, and that all patients who are eligible for that treatment should get it as soon as possible, and the treatment should not be delayed because they are under consideration for endovascular treatment. The second major recommendation was that there are patients who greatly benefit from treatment with endovascular therapy with stent retrievers. They have to be selected very carefully, and the guidelines actually give the selection criteria to choose those patients for whom there is the best evidence that they will benefit from this treatment. In writing the guidelines, we made use of the data from the randomized controlled trials, and therefore the evidence that we found was restricted to the type of patients who were enrolled in the studies. And so the evidence comes down very hard for those types of patients, but also is clear that there just isn't good evidence for other types of patients and that we really don't know as well whether they benefit or not. Along these lines, another major recommendation is the use of stent retrievers. And that's because stent retrievers were actually used in the vast, vast majority of the studies in the patients for whom benefit was shown. Other types of mechanical thrombectomy devices used in earlier studies did not show a clinical benefit, and the other ones currently available have not been tested adequately to know how they compare to stent retrievers. Also, in these guidelines, we have discussed the issue of using imaging criteria to select patients. In the studies that demonstrated benefit with stent retrievers, all used non-contrast CT to exclude hemorrhage and to identify patients with already large areas of damage. And they also use some kind of non-invasive testing, usually CT angiography, to identify those patients who had a proximal vessel occlusion and therefore were eligible for endovascular therapy. The best evidence is regarding those patients with internal carotid occlusion intracranially or proximal middle cerebral artery occlusion. There's really not very good evidence for any other locations of vascular occlusion because of the small numbers of patients that were studied. Although some of these studies actually used other sophisticated imaging criteria, CT or MR, there was not evidence that one set of criteria actually allowed choice of patients who benefited, nor should any of the criteria be used to exclude patients from undergoing this therapy if they otherwise meet the selection criteria outlined. Finally, we address the area of systems of care, and we all agreed that, as I said, patients who are eligible for intravenous RTPA should go to the nearest hospital that can give that to them, and they should get it, and then consideration should be made very quickly to transfer them, if necessary, to another institution that can perform the endovascular therapy. This will actually be a difference about the way stroke care is managed in many parts of the country, because we will need to set up networks for the ability to transfer patients quickly to those centers that can do endovascular therapy will be able to be carried out for those patients who will benefit. The recommendations that will be published reflect the work of all the members of the writing group and the staff at the American Heart Association, who was a great help putting those together. The outcome of these guidelines reflects the mission of the American Heart Association to promote health from heart attack and prevent stroke. And I thank you for listening.